Good morning, church. Katie, he's got it. He is risen. Okay, you know, if I say he is risen, you're supposed to say he is risen indeed. Amen? All right, so let's try that one more time. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Praise the Lord for the hope of the resurrection. Because, and Pastor Kevin is going to talk about that in a few moments, I know. But no matter what's going on around us in the world, no matter what is said, no matter what is done, we know that every Sunday actually is the day that we worship and celebrate the resurrection. That's why we do it on the first day of the week. But we praise God for all that He has done, for answers to prayer and for things to pray about. So I'm here by the grace of God. The surgery went well. Still a little bit of a discomfort, but it's hard to keep me away. But I'm glad that God was with me and for my family and for I felt all your prayers. So thank you for that. I'm glad to be here today. Bob is no longer suffering. He's in the presence of the Lord. Paulina's dad is no longer suffering either. He's in the presence of the Lord. So we're grateful for that. I know there's others with answers to prayer. We thank the Lord for the rain. We thank Him for what He's doing. We thank the Lord for the way the doctors have found out things about our granddaughter so that she can be dealt with properly. And we would ask prayer for Amelia. She has bilateral hip dysplasia, and so she will be wearing a brace for a few weeks till they get that taken care of. But they wouldn't have found it if she wouldn't have had the other problems. All things work together for good to them that love the Lord. Amen? So we're grateful for that. Amen. All the time. That's another call and response. You say, God is great, and you say, all the time. Amen? Amen. So I do pray for Isabel and the girls as they continue this journey. I pray for Paulina and her family as they go through this journey. Paulina, your dad passed on Saturday morning. All right, so we want to pray for him. The family, pardon me, pray for them that they'll have strength and comfort. Let's bow our heads in word of prayer, and then I'm going to talk to you about what's happening in our service today. We come humbly before you, Lord, thanking you for answered prayer. Many of these that are here today because of answered prayer. Lord, how you worked in a mighty way in their lives. You've helped them with their health. You helped them to find you and open up their hearts to salvation. So we're grateful for that. We're thankful for the resurrection. The fact that even though the darkest hour this world has ever known occurred when you were on the cross, that 3 days later you rose again. To get victory over death, to get victory over grave, to allow us to have that same victory as well. And because of that hope, we know that we'll see our loved ones that have trusted in you again one of these days. We thank you for all you're doing. We would pray that you might continue to work, be with Isabel's family, with Paulina's family, be with other health issues that we've been praying for, be with spiritual needs, those that are struggling with addiction, that you might help them, Lord, to come to you, but we pray for the lost, those that need Jesus Christ. Lord, above all things right now, this world needs Jesus Christ. And I pray that you'll help them have their eyes open through the Word, through the Holy Spirit, our family, our friends, our neighbors, Lord, that people will come to salvation. Through our help, through our work, Lord, the gospel is powerful. And we pray that as we plant the seed, whether or not we see the harvest, but at least we'll plant the seed of the gospel. Be in our services today. We want to lift you up and glorify you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I appreciate, once again, our ability to combine with Arise and Go, and they're here with us today. And because I asked Pastor Kevin if he would be willing to preach for us today, and he said yes. And I'm honored to have him as a friend, and have him as a fellow pastor in our community, and to know his heart for the gospel and to see people's lives changed. I'm also glad he asked his wife if she would be able to do worship for us this morning, and she said yes. So he'll be blessed this morning, and I'm going to turn the service over to him. We do have Bible study tomorrow at 9 o'clock and midweek as well, if you're interested in that. All right, and we're starting the Easter offering today. You'll see the plate by the plate, the offering envelopes for that. We'll do it through the month of April. All right? The Easter egg hunt will be in here right after church. All right? So our kiddos will be blessed as well. All right. Pastor Kevin.
Good morning, everybody. God bless you. We're going to do a quick prayer and ask the Lord to meet us. It's very important that we worship the Lord on Resurrection Day, right? It's interesting that Jesus, you know, when you hear people deny who he was out in the world, right? The Bible says, you know, don't rebuke a fool in their folly. So when people speak against the Lord in front of you, I know sometimes it grieves you, or they say his name in vain potentially, and something just doesn't sit right with you. But just pray for them, because the fact of the matter is, if you know the Lord, you know, the Bible says that the Father is seeking those to worship him in spirit and in truth. And Jesus says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So let's just pray and ask the Lord to meet us here. The Bible says that when you're born again, the Spirit of God is inside of you. So he's already here. So when we ask for his presence, we just ask that it's more magnified inside of us as we worship him and give him the glory, right? He gets all the praise. But let's first, Lord, forgive us for our sins. Lord, we pray in Jesus' name as we forgive those who trespass against us. Father, we meet you here. We ask that you would pour your Spirit out. We just want to spend this time today to worship you, to honor you, to adore you, and to love you. And we thank you that your great love for us, you consider us to be something valuable on this earth, and that one day we'll be with you forever. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Well, real quick, how many people need to know it as well with your soul through all the trials and tribulations and things going on in your life? Amen? Let me get my tears from dropping here. But let's pray. Lord, we come before you in the name of Jesus. We ask that you meet us here, Lord. You are the Word. In John it says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God, he was with God in the beginning. And the Bible says you're from everlasting, Lord. And the Bible says to sanctify us with the truth, and thy Word is the truth. You said, heaven and earth will pass, but your words will by no means pass. It is written, and the scripture cannot be broken. Father, we know that when you come back, which is soon, the Bible says you're simply going to speak with a double-edged sword out of your mouth, which will be the word of God to strike the nations and against all your enemies. But we're thankful, Lord, that we are not your enemies. We are your friends, and we are ones that you love and you adore. And you said, abide in my word. And that's what we want to do today, Lord. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. A to the men. Well, glad to be here for Sunday service. I'm not seeing a screen in the back. I'm good. I'm on. So let's start with a prophetic scripture. I like to get into the prophecies. You know, everybody knows that Jesus Christ, you know, he fulfilled over 300 prophecies. If you look at all the different religions in the world, there's one thing that they'll try to do, or Nostradamus and all these folks, is try to predict the future, and it's sort of vague, right? Like, oh, one day a man will rise, and yeah, well, that could be any day at any time. The good thing about the scripture is that God foretells what is going to happen before. You know, that way we can have trust, right? We, as you learn through the resurrection, right, as we learn the process of Jesus coming into Jerusalem, and they're, you know, they're saying Hosanna, which means save now, and they have the, you know, the palm branches, and they're throwing them on the ground. And back then, when a king used to come to town, they'd take the palm branches and sort of level out the street and make it straight, right? So make straight the way of the Lord. And then we know He told his disciples that the Son of Man will be lifted up, and all those who look on him will be healed. And that was Friday night. And then now it's very important that we understand the resurrection. The resurrection, without the resurrection, we really have nothing, right? If Christ isn't risen, then we can't rise. So it's very important that we understand the totality. So this may be a little different than you're used to on Easter Sunday, sort of the cookie cutter. Let's read through these scriptures and that scriptures. But we're going to get into some of the prophetic side. So this is in Hosea 6, 1 through 2. It says, "Come and let us return to the Lord." This is a call for repentance. "For he has torn, but he will heal us. He has stricken, but he will bind us up. After 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will," say a church, "raise us up that we may live in his sight." The prophecy of Jesus coming, the prophecy that he says, "I will put my spirit in them. I will give them a heart of flesh," that hard heart. If you notice, the carnal nature of us, the human nature is against God. Maybe perhaps you're scrolling on your phone and then something of God comes in and you're like, "Oh, let me scroll past that real quick," or that. That is just the human and the falling nature. It doesn't receive God until you're born again, and that's the promise that he'll raise us up. So let's do a little study here in Mark 16, 1 through 3. We're just going to read these out loud. It says, "And when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, had bought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him." The sweet spices, frankincense and myrrh and all kinds of different spices. Anybody smelled myrrh before? It's just such a beautiful scent. Of course, there's people who use it for nefarious reasons, but if you can get some anointing oil, you can go on to Amazon, frankincense and myrrh. It's just beautiful. A lot of the disciples, when they prayed for people, the Bible says they anointed them with oil. They cast out demons and they pray for them to be healed. So that's very biblical, and it's something that hasn't gone away, and the demons surely haven't left town, if you haven't noticed. And it's a really good touch point for faith, so I do recommend that. It says, "Very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came onto the sepulchre." Now, the sepulchre was basically a cut-out portion of stone. It was basically what we would call a grave today. It was where they would bury the dead, essentially. And one of the prophecies was that Jesus would be buried with the rich. So he was giving a very fancy grave, so to speak. And they came in the sepulchre and the rising of the sun, and they said among themselves, "Who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre?" And I say that wrong all the time, so forgive me. "And when they looked, they saw that a stone was rolled away, for it was very great. And entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted." They were scared. "And he said unto them, Be not affrighted. Ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He has risen." Amen. "He is not here. Behold, the place where they laid him." So the angel's basically just showing, hey, this is where he's at. He's not there anymore. "Go your way, tell his disciples and Peter, and go before you into all of Galilee. There shall you see him and say unto you." And they went out quickly and fled from the sepulchre, and they trembled and were amazed. Neither said they anything to man, for they were scared. Amen. Now, when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary. Now, this is important. This is extremely important. I'm going to break this down here very shortly, but look at this. We're going to read this. When Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast 7 devils, and she went and told that he had been with him, as they mourned and wept. Why are they mourning and weeping? He's no longer in the grave. Now this is the crux of the story here. "And when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they did not believe. So Jesus appears to his 2 disciples. After that, he appeared in another form to the 2 of them as they walked and went into the country. As they went and told, but they did not believe them either. Afterwards," if you notice, there's a pattern here. He's appearing. He's showing himself to several different people. But look at this. After he appeared unto the 11, as they sat and met, and unbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not, which they have seen him after he was risen. Now, church, we're going to get into the Bibles. They're right in front of you in your seats. And I'm going to ask you all to open up to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. What's the page number, daughters? 663, thank goodness. It's not the other one. So 663 in your Bibles, and we're going to read chapter and verse, and we're going to break these down. We're going to start in verse 5, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 5. Everybody let me know when you're there. It's very important that we be proficient in navigating through the Bible as we walk with God. These very words are very important, right? How would you know about Jesus if it wasn't for the Bible? How would you know how to be saved? The Bible says, whoever calls on the Lord shall be saved. Apart from the very words and that very important book in your hand, we wouldn't know. Everybody there? Amen. Amen. Let's read out loud. Verse 5. And that he was seen by Cephas and by the 12. After that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present. But some having fallen asleep, which means passed away. After that, he was seen by James, then by all the apostles. Then last, he was seen by me also. This is Paul speaking, as one born out of due time when Paul met him on the road of Damascus. You ever hear of, you had a road of Damascus experience when God, you met him. There's one thing to know of him. There's one thing to speak of him. There's another thing when you meet him and he knows you and you know him, and no one can take that from you. It's a precious thing to know the Lord. It's a precious thing to know God, the creator of the dimension we're in right now. It's interesting. So often our flesh, we just think we're immortal and we don't understand how fragile we are, and that the Bible says he's the Lord of hosts. He's the Lord of spirits. All the spirits on the earth. So there's a couple points here. In the Jewish law, it was required that two witnesses be established. So let me tell you this. If anybody is a Christian and they give you a word and they say, God told me you're going to be a bus driver at Chula Vista in a couple years. And you go, okay. Well, the Bible says don't despise prophecy. It very well make it happen, but what we do is we follow the Jewish law, sort of, that just the pattern where Jesus followed, where it was followed when he was seen by many. We wait for someone else to come give us. Someone you don't know. Say, Lord, send somebody else that would sort of confirm that word out of the mouth of two or three. And if it's crazy, you're going to be the president of the United States. Something like, Lord, send 500 people, because I don't know if I'm going to run with that. There's a lot of false prophets out there nowadays. Amen? So we have to test the spirits, but there is a way, a law that God has put in place where out of the mouth of two or three, every word shall be established, sort of in our court systems, right? If you have one person that's against you, it's he said versus she said, or he or she. But if you have two, well, then that's when they have sort of a good ground base to levy whatever they have. So there, he was not only seen by many, he was seen by the 500. So let's skip up to verse 12, and I'll read it. Everybody there? Now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? So Paul's addressing a church. There's just people, some folks in there that just snuck in the church and were denying the resurrection. And he said this, but if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty and our faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God, because your faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found, for whom you did not raise up, in fact, the dead did not rise. For if, check this out, verse 16, For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Amen? I use this analogy a lot. As a pastor, I probably sin maybe 3 times a day. If, you know, I try not to. You know, the sins of omission, something you don't catch. You fall short and you find yourself saying, Lord, please forgive me. If that's 3 times in a day on your best day, count that in a year. 3 times 365, pretty close to 1,000. 1,000 sins in a year. You got 1,000 sins in a year on your best day. If you live to be 80 years old, you got 80,000 sins. And you're going to come up to heaven and you're going to go, let me in, Lord. I'm a good person. And that's why the Bible says you're saved by grace through faith. It is a gift of God, not of anything you've done, lest any man boast. No man has ever entered heaven on his own righteousness. We have the righteousness of Christ, guys. We all fall short. Should we sin? Certainly not. But if we do, we have an advocate, Christ Jesus. Amen? If I didn't, I mean, what did David say? Lord, if you were to count my iniquities, who could stand? Who could stand? Not no one in here. You wouldn't be able to stand. And that's where our hope comes from. Because if Christ is risen, then we've risen. If Christ is alive, then we're alive. And the proof, I've seen God change people's life radically. You cannot tell me he's not real. You cannot tell me there's no power in his name. You cannot tell me he's not above all principalities, dominions, and powers. You know, what can separate you from the love of God? Angels, demons, principalities, powers, things, presents? Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Guys, listen. Friday night, he said these words, it is finished. Amen? It is finished. It's done. It's signed. It's sealed. The work he began in you, he will work it to the end. That is his promise. And guys, without him, we've got nothing. I don't know if you knew who I was. I was in the Marine Corps. I was a murderous man. I was a hateful person. I was a bad dude, man. And God, he pulled my ticket. He says, I'm going to pull your ticket or I'm going to pull your life from you. And he pulled my ticket, humbled me, and I met the living God. And it wasn't by anything else but faith. Faith in him. There's an old song out there. Johnny Cash, I don't know if you heard of it. Sooner or later, God'll cut you down. A man can only live so long rejecting Christ, rejecting his freedom, rejecting his grace, and holding him off until the tree cutter comes and chops the tree down. You fool, the Bible says, your soul is required of you this day. It was so simple. Lord, forgive me. I humble myself. I humble my pride. Lord, forgive me. And that's where you meet him. Because when he looked at the thief on the cross, it wasn't an elegant speech, the thief said. He just looked and said, Lord, don't even say the remember me when you go in your... He just said one powerful thing, Lord. If you believe Jesus is Lord and the Father raised him from the dead, the Bible says, you will be saved. Amen? It's a heart thing. And it takes the work of the Spirit, because no one can come to the Son unless the Father draws him. And I believe, everybody, if you're here, the Father has drawn you. Amen? You're either being drawn to him for salvation, or you're growing in the knowledge of Christ. Amen? Because you already have yourself. It's done. I'm saved. Devil, you're a liar. I'm what? Oh, you're no good. No one likes you. You preach like crap. People not going to like blah, blah, blah. My wife gets hit last night with every demon in town came because she was trying to sing. She was going to sing. And anxiety and all the spirits of the world came against us. And we're like, well, that's an honor, because if we got that going on, we know we're on mission. We're doing the right thing. Amen? Amen? Praise God. So look at, we'll finish this last verse. Verse 17. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile, and you are in your sins. Praise God, we're not. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, where all men would be pitiable. Look at, so this is it. It says, hope in this life is only pathetic. If your hope is in this world, it is pathetic. The grass will wither, the flower will fade, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Guys, I'm telling you, I lost my job a couple years back, and I found myself driving Lyft driver for a little bit, and I was waiting. I was like in this big queue over by the airport, and there was 1,000 cars, and no one was flying in. And I looked at the grass, and I just saw it was a lot of it was about to die, and the Spirit hit me. He's like, the grass will wither and the flower will fade, but the word endures forever. And I said, okay, God, well, guess what? I lost my job, but I know I got a better one coming. Amen. Amen. One door closed, there's another one open. Amen. Amen. He's got nothing but good for me. Amen. So what happened? A week later, better job. Right? And it's only gotten better. It's sort of like the Joseph thing. God can take you up through the pagan world and lift you, seat you high, and have you meet people so you can be a light in a very dark place. And that's the power of the resurrection. Salvation is required by a couple things. Romans 10:9, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. What does saved mean? Saved from what? Saved from what? Hell. Eternal flames. Because if you don't want Christ, the Bible says, you will go where the angels, the fallen angels, and Satan will go. There'll be no love, there'll be no mercy, there'll be no grace, there'll be no peace, there'll be no breath, there'll be no strength. Everything that you consider good here, which is a fraction of what's good really in the heavenlies, the Bible says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard what God has prepared for those who love him, for those who are called according to his purpose. You have no idea. As Apostle Paul says, I was there, but I'd be sinning if I told you how radical it was when I was up there. You guys know the John 3:16 verse, right? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. God always, Jesus never, Jesus isn't, oh, lovey-dovey, flying in the clouds, shooting down arrows of love on everybody. Oh, yeah, no, the Bible says Jesus will break you. The Bible says, come on this rock and be broken, or that rock will crush you into pieces. He is absolutely no joke. Thank goodness he's our God. Amen? I fear for the people who can shake their fists in the air against the living God boldly on the streets or on the televisions and raise their fists against Christ. And he's sitting there with arms wide open saying, I will forgive that person if they humble themselves. But we have to understand that's the negative, right? So that the positive is if you believe, you'll have everlasting life. The negative, because Jesus, there's always a negative there, and we're going to see a couple scriptures on that. Perish. Amen? Amen? Praise God for his resurrection. Praise God. Believe that God has raised him from the dead. Confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. Who wants to confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord right now? Right now, let's do it. Lord, we confess that you rose from the dead. And we believe in our heart. You're our God. Amen. Amen. Praise God for that. King of Kings. Let's go to verse 22. 1 Corinthians 15:22. For as in Adam, all die, even so in Christ, all shall be made alive. But each one in his own order. Christ is the first fruits. Oh, if we did a study, there's a great study on just the feast days and how the Lord came at the perfect appointed times and how we're almost at the catching up of the church, the rapture, which will happen one day. We're so close prophetically Israel must have become a nation, born in a day, which happened in 1948. They must have had their Six-Day War, which happened not too long after. They must have Psalm 83, where the Ring of Fire nations. Interestingly enough, Hamas and all those folks, and all the folks up in Lebanon, and we're starting to see that sort of shape up right now. And they're going to build the last temple and usher in the Antichrist until a third of them realize Jesus is the Lord. Amen? But don't ever sleep on Israel, because the churches began in Israel, in Jerusalem. Jesus didn't travel much. He preached to the lost sheep of Israel first. We are the Gentiles if you're not Jewish blood. And we're grafted in, according to Romans 11, we're grafted in to the promises of Israel. So the Bible says, don't you boast against Israel or speak evil against them, because those who speak evil against Israel, the Bible says, those who curse will be cursed. And you see it. All the nations that voted against Israel in the UN, all of those nations, they're overran. Their population is overran, and France is no longer what it used to be if you ever went to France now. Neither is the streets of England. But they would, and the Bible says that the nations of the earth will speak out against Israel. The UN, 104 times they've condemned Israel. The most out of all the world. Do you think that's a coincidence? Though all the nations rage against Israel, the Bible says the Lord will laugh in the heavens. So why do we get upset when people mock Jesus sometimes? When God's sitting there laughing in the heavens. The Bible says that the Lord knows the ways of the wicked, and he knows their day is soon. So why do we take so much offense sometimes? Because his spirit is in us, and when he's grieved, we're grieved too. And I personally can maybe calm down on social media a little bit, because when someone's blaspheming the Lord, I'm up there hitting them with the scripts. I'm going, boom, boom, I'll hit them with 50 scriptures. Because why? Because it's not about how eloquent we speak. It's about the word of God that changes people's lives. Amen? And it's the word, the very Bible that's in your hand right now, that speaks of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So powerful. So powerful. So let's read in verse 22. We'll start again. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all should be made alive, but each one in his own order. Christ the first fruits, afterwards those who are Christ at his coming. This is powerful. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom of God to the Father, when he puts an end to all rule and all authority and his power. So Christ is the first fruits. Those who are Christ are at his, I mean, there's three successive stages here. So the first fruits, Christ that is coming, then comes the end. This is going to be a little hard for me to read, but I'll try my best. In Revelation 20, 12 through 15, it says this, and I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and the books were open. How many people know God has a book of life? He has a book of life, and he's going to look, and he's going to see who's in it and who's not in it. This is very powerful. It says this, and another book was open. Another book. So there's two books. There's the book of life, and there's another book, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by these things that were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. How many people want to be judged according to your works? Raise your hand. I don't want to be in that other book. Amen? Who wants to be in the other book? No, because apart from Christ, guys, we will be judged. The Bible says as believers, you go to the Bema Seat judgment of Christ. It's the Bema Seat. It's Christ's judgment. You go before God, and the Bible says he gives you gifts, eternal rewards. It's very important. Jesus says, store up your heavens and your treasures in heaven where moth can't eat and rust can't destroy. He's very particular about storing up. Like, how many people, oh, I wish I was a thief on the cross and I just slipped into heaven in my last breath. Not me. It's very important that you store up your treasures in heaven. And these are the works that are done with the heart for the kingdom of God while you're here. While God has graced you with whatever amount of years you have left to serve him, to honor him, to see a homeless person and throw him a couple bucks, to give a waiter an extra tip that probably didn't deserve it, but the Bible says those who refresh others will be refreshed. Guys, all the broke people I know, they're broke. I'm broke, but they're real broke. They don't tip. If you don't give, it won't be given. If you give, it will be given. That is the promise. That's the promise of God. When you give, it'll be given. What's the negative? If you don't give, it won't be given. And all the things we do with faith. We believe in God in faith. We pray for people to be healed in faith. We pray for people to have jobs in faith. So why is it sometimes so hard for us to bless our fellow man who may be hurting, but we look at our financial situation? I just go, you know what, Lord? You said those who give to the poor will never be begging bread. I'm just going to believe it. Here you go, man. I was going to go get some food, but you have it. I got food at the house. Right? When you learn these wonderful truths of the Bible, you'll see the very words of the Bible play out, right? So I'm saved because I turned to God. He rose, and if he didn't rise, I'm dead, but since he rose, I'm alive. I believe that. Do you believe that?
Amen.
Amen. I believe that. That was a little, I call that an offshoot. Somebody needed to hear that. You know, and when I see some people go, it's like, you know, maybe you. The pastor, he sees everything. So the person who's cringing at the word of God, I'm not going to, you know, obviously I wouldn't say, it's you over there, you know, or something like that. It touches, the Bible says the word of God is living, powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It divides between the joints and marrow and the soul and the spirit. It cuts. It reveals us. God's ways are not our ways. God's ways are not our ways, guys. What you do on here on earth will matter on that day. But for these unfortunate people who rejected the free gift of eternal life, it says this. And they were judged, each one according to their works. Then death and Hades, which is hell, were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. If anyone was not found written in the book of life, was cast in the lake of fire. How many people believe in Jesus Christ? Raise your hand. He's your Lord. How did you know? By the word of God? You better believe that's going to happen. Oh, people don't send themselves to, you know, God doesn't send people to hell. No, he thrusts them into hell every day. He says, depart from me, you worker of lawlessness. I never knew you. Every single day, the Lord thrusts them. He's the judge. He's still sitting on the judgment seat. And the good news is, as believers, we're in the Bema seat. And the Bible says, whatever works we did with the wrong heart will be burned up. Not a big deal. But whatever we did with the right heart, whatever we truly did to bless. Let me ask you a question. You guys know the Ten Commandments, right? Don't steal, don't lie, don't commit adultery. What is that? It's love. Because when you steal from your neighbor, what does it do? It infuriates them. It hits their spirit. If you commit adultery with your neighbor's wife or husband, what does it do? It tears the family apart. It tears the person apart. If you bear false witness against somebody, what does it do? That's why Jesus says, here's the law and the prophets. Two of them, love your neighbor, love your Lord first, and then love your neighbor. All the law is on those two things. So easy, yet so hard in this world. We'll finish. Let's cruise over to verse 29. It's very dangerous, let me tell you this, guys, right now. It's dangerous to deny the resurrection. Very dangerous. Look up verse 29. Otherwise, what will they do who are baptized for the dead if the dead do not rise at all? Why then are they baptized for the dead? That's a whole different doctrine. We won't get into that. We certainly don't practice it as it may seem to be here. And why do we stand in jeopardy every hour? I affirm by the boasting in you, which I have in Christ our Lord, I die daily. If in the matter of men, I have fought with beasts in Ephesus, what advantage is it to me? If the dead are not rise, let us eat, drink, for tomorrow we die. Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. Awake to righteousness and do not sin. For some do not have the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. This is Paul really just speaking to the church about some issues in the church. But really the crux of this is him being beaten, him being stoned, him being shipwrecked, him being mocked, and him being by his own people for the gospel, because he really did meet Jesus. Sometimes we have to remember the former things, right? You may find yourself in a place where the enemy may have you, and he's telling you, you're no good, and God's not with you, and you really messed up now. You really met that lake of fire, that's for you. But you have to sit there and say, you know what, the enemy, he's a liar, and what I need to do is I remember when I first met Jesus. I remember God got me that job. I remember God did answer that prayer. I had back pain, guys, when I got out the Marines, 15 years. The worst pain. Well, a little less than 15, probably 10 years. The worst pain. That's my wife. Every month and a half, my back would go out. For almost 2 weeks, I'd have to take pain medicine and all this stuff. When I first got saved, this sister prayed for my back. She said, in Jesus' name. I was like, what? Ba-da-ba-da-ba-da. Completely healed. Black back is healed. All right? I started throwing up because I think there were some spiritual issues with me. But when I got up off that ground, my back was completely healed. I've never had back pain again. And sometimes I forget that. Sometimes I forget what God has done for me. I forget his love for me. I forget that every single time I've messed up, I said, Lord, forgive, and his grace was upon me, his spirit was upon me, his anointing was upon me, his power was upon me. He loves us, guys. He knew when he saved you where you would be right now. Amen? Amen? You have eternal life if you believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen? What's the negative? You don't have eternal life if you don't believe in the resurrection, Jesus Christ. As a pastor, and I'm a pastor, well, we are charged with preaching the full counsel of God, right? You can't just skip over verses sometime, and it's good to rightly divide the word, but there may be another verse right here, right? Jesus would tell people, if you knew, you know, the disciples or the Pharisees would come up to him and say something, and he's like, if you knew my father, you would know me. Your father is the devil. And they said, well, how can our father be the devil? Our father was Abraham. And Jesus would say, if your father was Abraham, you would do the works of Abraham. Now, probably some folks in our church already know this, but Abraham did a lot of works. I can count them on one finger. The Bible says Abraham had faith in God, and was accounted to him for righteousness. Amen? The just will live by faith, guys. Your faith has made you whole. Your trust in him. Why? Imagine this. You're the creator of an entire unit. Like, just think of it. I always use this analogy. There's a bunch of ants in an ant farm, and you're feeding them, and you're like, they're running around in there, and you're throwing stuff in there, and there's that one ant with his little whiskers up, kind of doing that. And you're like, he knows I'm here? That's how God is. It's impossible to please God without faith. Guys, the glory of the Lord is all around us outside. As soon as you walk out and you see the trees and the birds and the creation and everything that he's made, that his hand made, even in its cursed state, is amazing. And when you recognize him, he's pleased, because it's impossible to please him without faith. You can't even get saved without faith. Everything is on faith. If you believe in my word, he says, this is a, This iPad is pretty powerful, but that book in your hand is very powerful. Got a lot of keys. A lot of keys, guys. So it's essential to believe in the resurrection. Don't keep wrong company. Guys, if you're hanging out with the wrong crowd, bad morals will corrupt you, guys. Because you know what you find yourself as a believer? You'll be like, I'm not cool with that. I'm not cool with that. And you know, you kind of look away when they're saying stuff, and then eventually it's like, okay, okay. And all of a sudden you're going backwards and not forward. So we want to make sure we keep company with the saints. And honestly, guys, I don't have many friends. I don't have many friends. It is what it is. I don't have many friends. I'd rather hang out with the saints. I ain't hanging out with non-believers. The Bible says, do not fellowship with unbelievers. Because bad morals will corrupt your good character. Now, it's okay to hang out here and there, but if they want to hang out, go out and do things that God's not cool with, that's when the Bible says don't fellowship with non-believers. Amen? Amen. It's an intimate time with you and the Spirit and God. Because otherwise they will corrupt you. Because if they're not of God, they are the child of the devil. So it's just, sorry to say that, but not sorry, because it's right here in the Bible. And if your intention is that they get saved, amen. And you're coming in with the mission on getting them saved, amen. But I'm not going to go sell crack so I can save some crack dealers. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to go, live it up in the parties so a couple people in the party will be saved. No. We have to have wisdom. Amen? Because what? You could eventually get corrupt. Things start getting a little more acceptable, and all of a sudden you find yourself in the state that they're in when they need God. And you've got God. So you have to be wise. How many people are sort of lonely because they want to be around the people of God and anybody? Because that's me. I mean, it grieves your heart. It grieves your heart. Why? Because you're special. And that day is going to be great for you. Blessed are you when you're persecuted for. How many people have been at work and people don't even want to go to lunch with you because they know you're a Christian? You're probably going to talk about God. Raise your hand. I'm that guy. Oh, everybody around me will be like, hey, you guys going to go to lunch? And they'll look at me and they'll be like, definitely not him. Praise God. Praise God. Why? Blessed are you when you're reviled for his name's sake. We're almost done here, everybody. So how can we be raised up? How will we be raised up? Like putting a seed in the ground, the body comes up. It's different than when it was planted. And that is in our baptism. You know, it's the thief on the cross was the exception and not the rule. We can't make doctrine on the exception and not the rule. Jesus was baptized and his ministry started. Everyone in the Bible was baptized. Every single person. John the Baptist came and baptized everybody. Everybody in the book of Acts was baptized. Not only with the water, but in the Spirit and fire. Amen. Pray that you be filled with the Holy Spirit. That's what the Bible says. Amen. And very importantly, the thief on the cross was sort of the exception, but certainly not doctrine. Certainly not doctrine. In the resurrection, some stars will be more glorious than others. This is Daniel, the prophecy. It says this. This is a prophecy, guys. This is very important. It speaks about that very rightly divided to that chapter in Revelation we just read. At the time Michael stands up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people, there shall be a time of trouble. This is Jacob's trouble, such as never was since a nation, even that time. And even Jesus says, if those days were not shortened, even the elect wouldn't be saved. It says this, and at that time your people shall be delivered, every one who is found written in what book? The book of life, amen? And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake. This is the earthly resurrection. Remember, we're going to have to be absent of the bodies, to be present of the Lord. If you were to pass right now, you will be with the Lord. Amen? But there's a thousand-year millennial reign where he's going to be on the earth. The Bible says he's going to be, where is he going to be? In America? in Russia, in Africa. He's going to touch down on the Mount of Olives at Jerusalem. That's where he's coming back. And the Bible says he's going to rule with a rod of iron. He's going to dash the potter's clay. He is going to sit on the throne in Jerusalem as God on earth for 1,000 years. And that's what this is. The people that we will have, all of us will have brand new resurrected bodies. No sin can't die. No sickness. None of this. And we will rule and reign with him, because if you notice what Jesus said, he said that there will be people who will rule over 5 cities, rule over 3 cities, rule over 10 cities. Amen. And it's really based on what you do here on earth. Your salvation is sure. But what you're doing in the kingdom, millennial kingdom, now that's based on what you do for God on this earth in the meantime. And trust me, I'm not the best doing everything for God in the meantime. I'm like probably every one of you. But I know he's got a plan and a purpose for everybody in here. It's pretty amazing. It's pretty powerful. Let's keep reading here. Even at that time, in the time of your people shall be delivered, everyone who is written in the book, and many who is asleep in the dust shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to what? Shame and everlasting contempt. There it is. There's the truth. Those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the firmament, and those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. If you're wise, you'll tell people about the very salvation you have. I know it's tough. It's weird. It's kind of like, oh, wow. Guys, I remember I went to the store, and God will tell me. Oh, gosh, it's like, for me, it's a heavy burden. I don't know about you guys. And I'm like next to this lady, and I'm walking, and I'm like, oh, God's saying to say something to her, and I know it. And I'm like, no. Okay, I said, Lord, send somebody else. Send somebody else, Lord. Someone more eloquent. And I only heard God speak audibly to me 3 times in my life. And you know what he told me? He says, everybody said the same thing you just said. Go talk to her. I said, okay. Went over, and I said, Miss, I just want to tell you God loves you. You know, God has a plan for your life. And I told her, and she looked at me, her head tilted, and she says, before I got into this store, I was praying if God even knows me anymore. And makes me want to cry. It's those little things. It's tough to do it. It's not easy. The flesh is weak, guys. It's tough to pray. How many people hardly pray? Raise your hand. Guess what? I'm a pastor. I hardly read the Bible. I should read it a lot more. And you go, that's crazy. It sounds like he's read the Bible back and forth. You know what? It's in my heart. And I just rely on my gift a lot. But I can probably read the Bible a little more. How many people could read the Bible a little more? A little more? Let's be honest. A little more. I really rely on my gift. When I first got saved, I went through the Bible. It was in me. Nothing but verses came out of my mouth everywhere I went. And you may see a verse or two come out of my mouth. But I really rely on my gifts. In a way, it's faith. In a way, it's faith, guys. And I know God's pleased with it. Sometimes at our church, I don't even take any sermon. I just go, guys, we're open the Bible today. We'll see where God takes us. And everybody would go, man, that's speaking to my heart today. The plans of man aren't always the plans of God. Oh, we're so close, everybody. We're so close. Like the stars forever and ever. Let's read this. So there's 5 changes that take place in the resurrection, guys. We go from being corrupted, decaying, dying, to uncorrupted and incorruptible. Amen? We go from dishonor, shame, to glory. Amen? No one who is God's children will be put to shame. God doesn't, he's got no shame about who you are. Absolutely not. We go from weakness to power. And we go from the soulish man, the flesh, to the spirit. Amen? God could speak to us through the spirit. God could speak to us through the word. God will speak to us through many different ways, but it will always, here's the thing, guys. If a spiritual manifestation happens, it's got to do one thing. Line up with the word, and another thing. Glorify Jesus Christ. Amen? People barking like dogs and all that, that don't line up with the word, and that ain't glorifying Jesus Christ. Amen? So there's always a positive. The positive is the true church. The positive is the true spirit. The positive is those who abide in the word and believe in the word of God. And then there's the counterfeit that doesn't rightly divide the word of God. It doesn't rightly divide the truth. It just picks out certain things here and there and makes it just this smorgasbord of do whatever you want. Right? How many people have read the Bible, saw something, are like, ooh. It's amazing, guys. If you just humble yourself and go, you know what, God? You're my God. Maybe someday I'll try it your way. Right? So hard to do with this flesh, but yet so amazing when you start to like say, you know what, God, I'm going to follow that principle. Me and my wife, I don't know what time it is. I don't know what time service ends, but we were at, I got probably 1,000 stories here, but we let someone go ahead of us, and God took us to the front of the line. The Bible says, if you go in a great house, if you go to a party or dinner party or a family event or something at your job, and then there's all these wonderful seats and there's a nice seat, and you run over and take the nice seat, someone might come in and go, that's not your seat, go sit back over there. But if you humble yourself and you take the worst seat in the house, you take the chair that's barely, you know, just like it doesn't just seem right for you. I've done that. I went in to an office environment. I sat right in the back. All the big chair tables were there. I sat right in the back corner on the wall chairs. And there was someone in this, they told the guy to get up and told me to get in the chair. Why? Because Jesus said, when you go, do this. So it's like when you implement the word of God, when he says to do something, you do. Very powerful. When we're almost done. In closing, sorry, our church, sometimes I'll say in closing and I'll just go on forever and ever. So look, the mortal man is subject to death, but through the resurrection, we have eternal life. Amen? And guys, I'll never sugarcoat the Bible. You know, if it says, I got to say it, because I'm going to point, the Bible says the pastors will have a stricter judgment. So the Bible says, don't give the pastors a hard time, because they're the ones who are sort of, God has put over your souls. Oh, I don't need to go to church. I don't need to be under authority. Okay, that's fine. You can live that life. But there's not a whole lot of blessings there, and there's not a whole lot of fellowship there. There's not a whole lot of accountability there. There's not a whole lot of learning and growing there. Doesn't say you're not saved, but there is an authority structure. And I fear for the pastor who doesn't preach the full counsel of God, but I know your pastor does, and that's awesome. So let's look at this last couple verses. John 13:17-9. For God did not send his son in the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him is not condemned. That's the positive. How many people believe in Jesus? Raise your hand. Raise your hand. If you're sure. Remember that old commercial? I probably got. I need to be sure. I don't wear too many collared shirts, guys. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is what? Condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, but men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds are evil. Instead of saying, Lord, forgive me for this darkness, it is, no way, I like my darkness. There's a guy on YouTube, he runs around on the streets and he goes, do you believe in Jesus? Do you believe? And he goes through like 1,000 people and everyone's like, nope, nope. This one lady's like, I used to, but I got rid of him a long time ago. I was like, oh, poor fragile person. Our days are numbered. And they could be numbered today. Like a vapor. You're here today, you're gone tomorrow. I feel bad. But the Lord laughs at those things. I don't. I feel sorry. Mark 16:15-16. And he said to them, go into the world. This is back on the 16 that we first read. This was after he was resurrected. After they were witnessed. After that, he said this. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes, this is to the evangelist. But of course, we all have our little job to talk about Jesus. He says this. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be what? Condemned. Why is that? Because we're born into iniquity. The prophet David said we were born into sin. Through one man's sin, Adam, death passed to all men. But through one man's righteousness, many will be saved. Amen? Praise God. Amen. So none of us in here who raised their hand says you believe in Jesus are condemned. Amen? Amen. So wear your head up high. Wear your head up high. And if you didn't raise your hand and you don't believe in Jesus, those very words will not fall short. Those words will not fall short. It will happen. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though they may die, he shall live. Amen? So it's all about believing, guys. And we're almost done here. Romans 10:9. That if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Last verse. There is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Because you're born again. He's given you his Spirit. And we're done here. Last verse. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as is written, the just shall live by faith. Amen? You didn't have to face east and bow down. You didn't have to go, oh, hold your hands like this. You don't have to hold your rosary prayer and pray to someone who can't save you 1,000 times if you sin. You don't have to go to a priest and bow down and tell him all your confessions. You don't have to go meditate until you reach nirvana. You just have to believe the Lord died on the cross for your sins and the Father raised him from the dead. Amen? He is risen. My wife is going to close in a song on the way out. He is risen. Amen? And therefore you are too. I hope you guys have a blessed day. Let me just pray real quick. Lord, I thank you for everybody in here, your beloved pastor, Lord, your sheep that you love with all your heart. Encourage them today that they are your children and they are blessed and that they should keep their hope in you and be so thankful for their salvation, Father God, because it's a serious thing. It's a serious thing. And I just pray we're reminded of all the great things you've done for us. Bless your people here. Anoint them with the Spirit. May they leave with great peace today. In Jesus' name. Everybody said? Amen. Amen. Let's close out, sweetie. Yeah. First song. Sorry, I'm not a DJ. Hit it, DJ. Let's get it. Yeah, God bless God. It was the other song. The other song. First song. Oh, I guess. Not too late. No, it's good.
we'll be drawn into the midst of the sea. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, lead us well. And through it all, my eyes are on you. It is well. Thank you.